In the year 2 BC, a dancer named Pylades decided to put on a festival. At night, in the forum, women of distinction took to a stage. They were introduced to whoever was there. And what ensued was what Cassius Dio tells us were revels, drinking parties. And one of these women was the emperor's own daughter, Julia, a married woman, apparently engaging in public commerce. One of the men, to Augustus's horror, was the son of his old nemesis, Mark Antony. Her extramarital lovers were numerous enough to be described using the plural. Some of them were put to death, others were banished. Julia herself was sent to the island of Pantateria, a craggy place where she resided like a mythological villain. Suetonius tells us, after Julia was banished, he denied her the use of wine and every form of luxury, and would not allow any man, bond or free, to come near her without his permission, and then not without being informed of his stature, complexion, and even of any marks or scars upon his body. You couldn't gain access to Julia without being strip-searched, essentially. It is as though Augustus needed to be sure that none of Julia's male visitors, head to toe, had anything to commend them as a potential lover for her. These things may have irritated her, but I wonder if such precautions only increased and elevated the legendary nature of her sexual potency. The Roman people, as we might guess, loved her. They missed her in her banishments. These people who had seen her paraded on the stage, they weren't offended. Suetonius tells us that the Roman people several times interceded for her and urgently pressed their suit. Cassius Dio does even better in Book 55, Chapter 13. The people pressed Augustus strongly to recall his daughter from exile, but he retorted that fire should sooner mix with water than that she should be allowed to return. Thereupon the people threw many firebrands into the Tiber. At the time, this produced no effect upon the emperor, but later they urged him so insistently that she was at last brought from the island to the Italian mainland. It is quite a thing for the Roman emperor to feel like he was forced to act, so agitated were the people. That tells us a lot about how the people felt about Julia. It tells us about her popularity, and that her popularity was so powerful that it was not the kind to be forgotten after 5 years. The firebrands in the water tell us that the Roman people missed their orgiastic Roman princess. Augustus could not have liked this. He had been implementing procreative policies, pro-family policies. Consider the details we get from the story of how Livia was consoled when her son Nero Drusus died. Now we got to remember, Livia was Augustus's wife. She had two sons by her previous marriage. The first was Tiberius. The second was Nero Drusus. But Drusus died on a campaign in Germany. In Book 55, Chapter 2, Cassius Dio tells us, as a consolation for Livia, statues of herself were voted and her name was inscribed upon the list of mothers who had borne three children. There are a number of exceptional cases in which the law confers the privileges belonging to parents of three children upon men and women to whom the gods have not granted that number. They are given all but a few of the rewards given to those who bear large families. There are incentives from the state to have children, preferably three or more. Suetonius tells us, to keep up the supply of men of rank and induce the commons to increase and multiply, Augustus, when he made his rounds of the districts, he distributed 1,000 sesterces for each child. Suetonius also writes that he even read entire volumes to the Senate and called the attention of the people to them by proclamations, for example, the speeches of Quintus Metellus on increasing the family. Let us take this story that Cassius Dio tells us, Book 54, Chapter 16. Since the freeborn population contained far more males than females, he allowed all those who so desired, with the exception of senators, to marry freed women, and directed their offspring should be regarded as legitimate. So first we have to note this disparity between males and females. And then we can wonder why Augustus thought that this was the solution to the problem, to allow freed women to marry up. Here's why I think Augustus thought that was a solution to the problem. This is not unique in history to find a ratio in the population where males exceed females. In Horst Fuhrman's book, Germany in the High Middle Ages, the historian there is dealing with the period between 1050 and 1200. And he tells us that upon examining the documents in the old city of Fulda, the ratio of males to females among the total population was 318 to 237. From this fact, it has been deduced that there was a kind of birth control through female infanticide. The penitentials and synods of the early Middle Ages dealt with the problem of mothers who crushed or suffocated their children in sleep. So I think the solution to the issue of infanticide was to dangle the prospect that your daughter might one day marry up and that your descendants would be in a higher class than you. There are additional details I find odd regarding Roman family life. So just because he wanted marriages to be used as vessels for procreation doesn't mean that there was always an interest in marital harmony. Let's take this example. Suetonius writes, "It was with great reluctance that he allowed even his generals to visit their wives, and then only in the winter season." And now we had also read that in the seating arrangements of the games, the married men sat amongst themselves. We saw that they were favored and that they got their own special section, but their wives didn't sit with them. Isn't that odd? Now, in Book 56, Cassius Dio tells us in 56, Chapter 1, "The knights in the course of the games had pressed him strongly to repeal the law concerning unmarried and childless individuals." Now, the footnote, I use the Ian Scott Kilvert translation, and his footnote says that unmarried men and women were debarred from certain categories of inheritance and from full participation in civic life. Amidst these grumblings, Augustus gives a speech. Here are some quotes from this speech. Book 56, Chapter 3. "Is there anything more admirable than a wife who is modest, who cares for her home, is equally versed in the management of household and the upbringing of her children?" And then 56, Chapter 3, he says to the unmarried men, "You are guilty of murder by not begetting in the first place those who should be your descendants." 56, Chapter 7, "What you want is complete liberty to lead an undisciplined and promiscuous life." 56, Chapter 8, "It is impossible for the city to maintain itself unless its population is replenished by a continual flow of new life." So these are the ways he guilt trips them. He makes them feel bad about being murderers, bad citizens who are of questionable manhood. All right, so now to transition into some of his religious policies. It would seem as though Augustus did not like the idea of Romans being exposed to foreign religious practices. Cassius Dio writes in Book 53, Chapter 2, "He forbade Egyptian rituals to be celebrated within the city limits." And in Book 54, again, "He curtailed the celebration of Egyptian rites, which were again creeping into the city. He forbade anyone to practice these, even in the suburbs, up to a radius of 1 mile. But in 19 BC, the historian tells us that when the emperor had arrived in Athens, he was initiated into the mysteries of the two goddesses. These mysteries involved rites which are unknown to us, the mysteries of Eleusis. It was punishable by death to reveal these mysteries in ancient Greece, and Augustus was sensitive to this, as we see in Suetonius. Some priests of this Greek cult came before him in a legal matter, and sitting in judgment of a case at Rome involving the privileges of the priests of Attic Ceres, in which certain matters of secrecy were brought up, he dismissed his counselors and the throng of bystanders and heard the disputants in private. So this tells us that he considered exotic cultures to be worthy of his own curiosity, indeed his own initiation into them, but he would not allow the rest of the people to engage in them. He was also hypocritical in his treatment of Julia, because we see in Suetonius that he was given to adultery, not even his friends deny. We also know that he brought obelisks over from Egypt and put a great deal of effort into it. Pliny the Elder tells us that there are two particular obelisks which were in Caesar's temple at Alexandria, one of which was placed in the circus so that the rotation of the chariots would mimic the planets and the sun. We also believe that an obelisk was aligned with the equinoctial path of the sun at the greatest monument from the Augustan era, the Altar of Peace. The obelisk was meant to represent a sunbeam. It was therefore a symbol of solar germination as well as virility. The friezes on the walls on the inside of this monument show him to be reaffirming his deified nature, the significance of his family, entwined with obligations to the state. And acting upon that precept, Augustus had no compunction about forcing marriage within his family. All three of Julia's marriages were to the heir apparent at the time, starting with Marcellus, and then Agrippa, and then Tiberius. The first two dying, it is Tiberius who is next. Augustus forced him to adopt Germanicus, who was his great-nephew, Octavia's grandson, and therefore Mark Antony's grandson, Germanicus. Heading into 9 AD, Dalmatia has been a significant theater for the Roman military, and in this year, we see both Germanicus and Tiberius devoted to subduing the Dalmatians under a leader named Bato. He fortifies himself at a stronghold at Andetrium, and only after a great deal of casualties and hard fighting do the Romans actually win this battle. But just as Germanicus and Tiberius are planning to celebrate this victory, news comes from Germany of a terrible, devastating defeat.